Frederick West. Professor West is a professor of chemistry and adjunct professor of oncology and chair in oncology, and the current acting dean of the Faculty of Science at the University of Alberta. Dr. West received his bachelor degree with honor at the University of Arizona, and his PhD from Wisconsin Medicine, where he was an NSF postdoctoral fellow. He then spent 2 years in Columbia University as an NIH postdoctoral fellow before starting his independent career as assistant professor at the University of Ottawa at the Department of Chemistry. During his 13 and a half years in Ottawa, Dr. West graduated 18 PhD and 6 master students, and received several major recognition, including being named at Eli Lilly grantee and university professor. He also co-founded a company in pharmaceuticals. In 2002, he moved to the University of Alberta, where he has run a large research program. 11 graduated master students, 33 graduated PhD students, 18 completed. In addition to being named the Allard Chair, he has been recognized with the Bernard Belot and Alfred Bader Awards of the Canadian Society for Chemistry, the Rutherford Award of for Excellence in undergraduate and undergrad teaching, the Killiam Award for Excellence in Monitoring, and was named a McCallum Professor, all at the University of Alberta. Dr. West's research has focused on novel synthetic methods in organic chemistry, total synthesis of natural products, medicinal chemistry, and chemical biology. Welcome, Professor West, to your talk.
Research know that, as Dr. Khaled said, we do a mixture of organic chemistry and medicinal chemistry, and that medicinal chemistry includes work in the antiviral area and work in the cancer area. And the cancer work ranges from molecular imaging, which you'll hear about later this morning from my former co-worker, Dr. Marwa, who successfully defended her PhD yesterday. Very exciting for me. As well as various therapeutic approaches to cancer. And what I'd like to tell you about today is a story about trying to use inhibition of DNA repair as a cancer therapeutic strategy. So I think everyone knows that our cells have to have a very robust mechanism for correcting damage to DNA, because our DNA is so important for the successful functioning of cells. And DNA is constantly subjected to various kinds of damaging stimuli. So that could include reactive oxygen species coming from cellular metabolism, various types of radiation, chemical electrophiles from external sources, as well as just occasional mistakes that get made during replication. And so we have to have ways to fix that. And the cell can adjust to DNA damage by a variety of mechanisms, up to and including apoptosis. But ideally, the cell recognizes and fixes that damage before that sort of irrevocable step. But there might be times, actually, when we don't want the cell to repair DNA. And one particular example would be when we're trying to treat cancer with DNA damaging agents. So in that case, when the cell correctly, successfully repairs the DNA damage, that then counteracts the effect of the treatment. And I show here some common cross-linking agents that are used clinically, beginning, of course, with cisplatin, which is now a very old drug, but still used clinically, as well as various other more recent derivatives of cisplatin, mitomycin C, a natural product, and cyclophosphamide. All of these compounds are able to cross-link DNA, and then that, if that happens selectively in tumors, that becomes an effective treatment. So just to remind you, here shown for cisplatin, there's different ways you can cross-link DNA, and by far the most devastating way is inter-strand cross-links. The example on the far right, that's much more difficult to repair, much more effective way of killing cancer cells. So I want to talk about a specific protein, ERCC1-XPF. And ERCC1-XPF is actually involved in several different important DNA repair pathways. So for example, inter-strand cross-link repair, but also nucleotide excision repair and double-strand break repair. But I really want to focus on inter-strand cross-link repair because, as I just said, that's the kind of damage that we actually want to inflict on cancer cells when we're treating them with DNA damaging agents. And way down at the bottom of that slide, if you can see it, is a very important reference from 2010 where they noted that cells in which ERCC1-XPF has been downregulated, those cells are much more vulnerable to cisplatin. And so that sort of implicates ERCC1-XPF as a very integral repair enzyme for the lesions that are caused by cisplatin. So ERCC1-XPF was actually discovered not in the context directly of cancer, but of a genetic disease known as xeroderma pigmentosum. And this is a disease that you'll sometimes see referred to in the popular press incorrectly as an allergy to sunlight. It's not an allergy, it's just an intolerance to the UV light that we get exposed to when we step out into the sun. And all of us, when we're exposed to UV light, will experience dimerization of pyrimidines to form these kinds of cyclobutane structures shown on the right. But most of us then can remove those damages before they become severe. But unfortunately, if you have a mutation in one of the XP proteins, and they range from XPA to XPH, I believe, any of those proteins, if it's mutated, you become unable to repair those pyrimidine dimers. And so gradually cellular damage builds up. Now, the repair of pyrimidine dimers involves a number of XP proteins, but it turns out XPF, or rather ERCC1-XPF, is very important in repairing pyrimidine dimers. So let's talk a little bit about the protein. It's heterodimeric, so that's why it's called ERCC1-XPF. XPF is the nuclease part. So the active site for repairing the DNA damage is found on the XPF protein. The ERCC1 protein, though, is essential, first of all, for recognizing the damage to the DNA. Usually when DNA gets damaged, its conformation gets buckled, and that change in topology in the DNA strand gets recognized by proteins like ERCC1. But ERCC1 also acts to recruit other proteins and form a larger multi-protein complex that's necessary to carry out some of the damage repair. The two proteins form this protein-protein interaction through two helix hairpin helix domains, one found on each protein. They intercalate with each other and form a very tight bond. Now, it's important to know that even though XPF has all of the nuclease activity, it's completely inactive unless it's dimerized to ERCC1. So XPF by itself is catalytically dead. And in fact, if these proteins are not dimerized to each other, they become degraded very quickly within the cell because they become conformationally unstable and they're targeted then for protease destruction. So a few years ago, scientists did a mutagenesis study, and they found that there's a very important amino acid in ERCC1 with a phenylalanine side chain that intercalates into a pocket in XPF. And when they did a mutagenesis study and replaced that phenylalanine with glycine or alanine, what they found is that very significantly destabilized the dimer. So what that means is if you prevent that phenylalanine interaction, you can cause the heterodimerization to not occur. If the heterodimerization doesn't occur, then you have no nuclease activity. So rather than targeting the active site, we can target the protein-protein interaction and accomplish the same thing, inhibiting DNA repair damage. So that was our hypothesis. And back in 2013, our collaborator, Dr. Jack Tuzinski, carried out an in silico screen with a series of commercially available compounds in a library and looked for compounds that would interact with that pocket on XPF. And he found several hits, ordered the hits, and found these three compounds were actually active, weakly active against ERCC1 XPF nuclease activity. And we were particularly attracted to the compound on the right, F06, because we saw that as a compound that could be readily modified and optimized for both drug-like properties and also potency. So after that initial study, my student, Ahmed El-Manoufi, and Jack Tuzinski's student, Francesco Gennari, worked together to do a much more in-depth computational study of F06 to understand what the key non-bonded interactions are inside that pocket, and they worked out a really robust pharmacophore model that we then used to propose a series of new derivatives. So starting with F06, you'll notice it has just a simple methyl group coming off of that papyrazine. And Ahmed and Francesco proposed a series of more elaborate compounds where we start building off of that papyrazine with various types of groups besides methyl. So larger alkyl groups, benzyl groups, substituted aryls, polar side chains, and even a case down there in the bottom right where there is no papyrazine at all. These compounds range in molecular weight from about 350 to about 650 and had calculated log P's anywhere from about 2.5 to 7.5. So once we had those compounds in hand, Ahmed made them all, we wanted to screen them. And the screen we use to detect nuclease activity takes a DNA stem loop structure there in the middle and uses it as a mimic for the kinds of DNA topology that ERCC1 XPF would encounter if it's repairing some sort of damage in DNA. So a stalled replication fork, or the kind of bubble that forms when you modify a DNA base and they break apart, that is mimicked in that stem loop structure. So if we take some stem loop DNA with known incision points on it, and then on one end we place a fluorophore, and on the other end we place a quencher, that compound is not fluorescent. But if ERCC1 comes in and clips it, then the fluorophore can diffuse away from the quencher and we see fluorescence. And so what we should expect if ERCC1 XPF is functioning is a time-dependent increase in fluorescence as that compound continues to get cut. If we run that experiment against a series of potential inhibitors, if we're seeing inhibition, we'll see a decrease in the rate at which fluorescence grows. So I show here a typical kind of plot with the compounds I showed you on the earlier slide plotted. So time is the x-axis, arbitrary fluorescence is the y-axis. What you see is the top line is the control, and there's a whole bunch of these compounds that are almost indistinguishable from control. So they're not in any way slowing down the cleavage of that stem loop. But then you see there's several compounds that have lower slopes, and that indicates that we are inhibiting ERCC1 XPF. And I'll draw your attention to the bottom line, which shows quite a large inhibition, much more effective than F06. And that compound is compound 4, or A4, as we've labeled it on this structure. And that was our first a significant hit from this study. So an IC50 of about 300 nanomolar. We then measured a dissociation constant. That was sort of in the same ballpark. We got about 100 nanomolar for that. And we see here a comparison with another compound, A5. And if you look at A5 and A4, you see they have very similar structures, but A5 is completely inactive. That was one of those compounds on the previous slide that overlapped with control. And we also see that A5 has an unmeasurable binding to ERCC1 XPF. So that simple change between an amino ethyl group and an aryl group gives us a huge difference in binding and inhibition. Now I also want to just talk about the acridine briefly. We were interested in removing the one ring of the acridine. So for example, that compound there is a clinically used antimalarial drug, looks very similar to A4. And even more interesting is this antimalarial drug, pyrineridine, which is used clinically in Asia. And we thought, well, this is quite similar, except it has that extra nitrogen, and it has two of these pyrrolidine rings. So I'll come back to pyrineridine in just a minute, but I'll point out that we tested it in that same assay, and that corresponds to Q4 there at the bottom, which is even more active than A4. So before I talk about that, I just want to mention these compounds are intrinsically cytotoxic, and so when we get to about 10 micromolar, they're very effective at killing cells on their own. So if we want to look at their activity in just inhibiting DNA repair, we need to stay in a lower concentration regime, maybe 2 micromolar at the most. So here's a cellular assay that we did. And here what we're looking at is the rate at which pyrimidine dimers are repaired. So you can shine a light on cells in culture. They form pyrimidine dimers, and then those dimers get repaired. You can measure the rate that the dimers are removed using an immunofluorescence assay, because there is a fluorescent antibody that binds specifically to that pyrimidine dimer. And so what we found is compound 5, remember that's the inactive compound, shows no difference from control at the rate that the pyrimidine dimers are removed. But compound 4, that was our first active hit, greatly slows down the rate of pyrimidine repair. So that, again, sort of argues that what we're doing is inhibiting ERCC1 XPF, and importantly, this compound is getting into the nucleus to do that. So a significant gap there. Here's sensitization results with compound 4, where either UV light or exposure to cyclophosphamide gets enhanced by the presence of compound 4. So we see greater cell greater cell death in the presence of 1 or 2 micromolar compound 4, as compared with just treatment with UV or just treatment with cyclophosphamide. So we wanted to be sure that the way these compounds were working was by inhibiting heterodimerization rather than somehow directly impacting the active site. So we used a technique known as proximity ligation assay, where we have antibodies to each of the two proteins in the heterodimer, and then antibodies to those antibodies. Those secondary antibodies have short DNA sequences, and when those hybridize, they form circular DNA in a series of concentric loops, which can then be converted into fluorescent dots if they're incubated with fluorescent monomers. And the upshot is, if these proteins are bound to each other, the antibodies will be close enough to each other in order to form these loops, and we see fluorescent red dots in the cell. And what we found is, and this is a very complicated slide, so I'm going to just simplify it and draw your attention to two situations. When we treat cells with just cisplatin, what we see is an increase in the number of red dots. That's the response of the cell to the DNA damage. It upregulates ERCC1 XPF. If we treat those cells with cisplatin and compound B9, whose structure I will show you in just a minute, we see almost no red dots. And so the upshot is we're preventing dimerization of ERCC1 XPF. And the structure of B9 is almost the same as the structure of A4, except that it's lacking a methyl group on the pyridine oxygen, or sorry, the acridine oxygen. Okay, real quick, I just want to tell you about two recent next generation compounds. One of them is C1. C1 resulted from a systematic study of the tether and the substituents on the nitrogen, and it turns out that the diacepropyl has real advantages. It actually has a reasonable log D of 3.9 at pH 7.4. It seems to bind very well in that pocket, and it's significantly more potent and comparable in binding to A4. What we really like about it, though, is this result. Sorry, not this result. This is the repair of the pyrimidine dimers. No, but this sensitization study. And in the interest of time, I just want to draw your attention to the chart on the far right, where what you're looking at is the effect of increasing amounts of ionizing radiation versus cell survival in the presence of either 0.5 or 1 micromolar of compound C1. And what you see is that seriously drops the curve, meaning that the same radiation is more toxic in the presence of relatively small concentrations of C1. The last example I'll give you very quickly concerns a very recently published study we did with the Chithrani group at University of Victoria, where what they found is that gold nanoparticles, which is what they study as a way of enhancing ionizing radiation, are further augmented by the presence of pyrineridine. Okay. So very quickly, these are the things I want you to remember. ERCC1 actually is an attractive target for cancer therapy. We found four very promising compounds shown at the bottom here. We think we have very good evidence that what's happening is inhibition of heterodimerization. And we've shown that these compounds sensitize cells to a variety of DNA damaging therapeutics, whether that be UV light, cross-linking agents, or ionizing radiation. And we have ADME results on all four of these compounds that suggest that they are viable for carrying forward and optimizing for preclinical animal studies. So all that remains is to acknowledge my coworkers, and I'll single out two people, Ahmed El-Manoufi, who got his PhD with me a few years ago and now has come back to do a postdoc in my group, and James Donnelly, a current PhD student. I also want to thank my collaborators. So Michael Weinfeld there in the middle heads up the Alberta DNA Repair Consortium. Jack Tuzinski did a lot of the computational work, as well as Khaled Barakat. And then Lars Jordheim carried out the proximity ligation assay. We're collaborating with Afsane Lavasanifar on novel formulations, particularly nanoparticles. And finally, Quincy Chu is a clinician that's helping us move towards those preclinical studies. So finally, I want to thank again the organizers for inviting me, and thank you so much for your attention.